Thank you for joining to How to Approach DISA, ASD, and STIG Compliance for Software Development. I want to introduce our speakers today. We have Arthur Hicken, Parasoft Evangelist, and Wilhelm Hacker, Parasoft Senior Solution Architect. So let me now pass it over to Arthur. Arthur?
Hi, Erica. Thanks.
So,
let's talk a little bit about the STIG itself, right? So the first thing is that the Defense Information Systems Agency has all of these security technical implementation guides. And the point of these things is to help people make sure that when they grab some product, particularly a COTS product, that they can make sure that it's installed and configured in a way that it's secure. So you might have one for your operating system, you might have one for your database, you might have one for your app server, things like that. There is one in particular that mentions secure software development, and that's the DISA ASD STIG, which is what we'll be covering today. And that's for software that you create or that you cause to be created, not for COTS software. And it's not, even though it says development in the name, it's less focused on development than it is on deployment. So we're going to go into that so that you get a better feel for it. And I just wanted to cover, when you download the STIG, there is this document that comes with it, this little README that has an intro. And I apologize for those online that are really familiar with STIGs. Like if you're an ops person, you probably got this down pat. But for those of us on the development side, the STIGs seem a little alien sometimes. So I just want to cover a few things real quick. Basically, if you read the executive summary there, you see at the end of that second paragraph that the point of this is to help people configure and maintain security controls for their application. So if as a developer, you feel like this isn't giving you the guidance you need to improve your secure coding practice, you are correct, but it's hidden in there. We're going to show you how to find it. So one thing I just want to point out, because some of the confusion people have comes around versioning. The current version is 4.6. There was a version 3 years ago that had very specific static analysis coding standard guidelines, like very granular. Those no longer exist. And the problem, of course, is that in the age of the internet, all of the information around that still exists. So if you Google something like DISA STIG static analysis, you're going to find configurations that are ancient and out of date. And that's because they're for version 3. So just keep that in mind. One of the things that changed in version 4 is that there are no longer specific coding standards. And this is part of a trend across industry and government to not keep reinventing the wheel. There are lots of good secure coding standards out there. So when someone needs one, rather than create a new one, the newer tendency is to reuse them. And so we see people trying to link to CERT and CWE and OWASP and things like that. And that makes a lot of sense. So they do recommend as part of this a vulnerability assessment. You can see that in the STIG V69513. And there are a few of the particular requirements that are specific about static code scanning, 70277, which talks about various kinds of overflows, race conditions in 70185, and various problems that you could get from error handling issues and leaking information and error handling and leaving the system exposed in improper error handling. It's actually a pretty big category, but that's 70391. So those are there, and we're going to go into those in detail in a moment. But there are other things that you can use static analysis for to help find things earlier and to fix them. But these would still require an audit to validate them. So it's something that you can use to improve your development process, but it won't necessarily help you on the audit side. So now what I want to do is a poll. Give me a second here to launch it. And you should see on your screen, just do poll one, which is how frequently do you STIG? Actually, I guess we'll just go ahead and answer both questions right now since we messed up our polling software. But put in how frequently do you have to do activities that are involved with STIG compliance? Is this something that happens once a year? Is this something that you do once a month at the end of the month? Is this something that you do? I feel for you if it's daily. I expect this number to be zero, but we'll take a couple more. And also, like I said, take a second, scroll down, and let us know what language the applications that you are, in particular, not just everyone you're using, but ones that you know that you have to do DISA STIG compliance for. Because that's really what we're looking when we talk about static analysis. There's usually a lot of language dependency, and so it's interesting to know what people are doing. So a lot of you voted. We'll give you just another minute here to cover this, and then we'll talk about what we found. So let's see. I think we've got everybody that we're going to vote, so we'll go ahead and end that poll. So the interesting thing that we find from this, we're seeing that about almost 40% of you said monthly you're doing STIG activities, and almost 40% said annually, and then the rest were quarterly and other. So it is something that you're there's a big gap between monthly and annually, so it's kind of intriguing. But I'm interested in, like, you know, how much effort, how much work are you putting into it? So that's intriguing. From a language perspective, C and C++, the big winner. About 75% of you are using C and C++, half Java, half .NET or C#, and about 15% Python, and 38% have some mix of JavaScript, etc. And half of you got something else. So some interesting numbers. So I guess the big question that comes up is, do I have to do this? Like, does this apply to me? Is this something that belongs to my application? There's a fact on the DISA website. We have the link here, and all these links will be on the final slide, and we'll put them in the chat box for you. So don't panic, even though they're long. But basically, if you look at the fact, the idea is that information systems that receive, process, store, display, or transmit DoD information have to do this. So pretty much, unless it's a weapons system, there was an exclusion for weapons systems. So other than that, you pretty much have to do it. So that's the answer. Do I have to do this? Probably yes. So let's talk about the STIG itself, right? Like, you go and you download the STIG. That URL was on the earlier page. Again, I'll put that in the last, but it's actually an XML file, right? There's some PDF files and stuff in there, and there's an XML file. And you don't actually have to unzip the thing. Like, Wilhelm and I talked about this, but the readmes and stuff are in there. So I would unzip it, but you don't, when you use the viewer, you don't have to. So you can open Excel in some Excel editor, XML editor, a development editor. You can open it in Excel, but I really wouldn't bother. It looks really horrible. I didn't even bother to save it. The problem is that when you're looking at XML, it's a lot like trying to decode the matrix, right? You're trying to figure out, oh my gosh, what am I doing? And it's kind of painful. So there's a viewer for this, and you can download this viewer. It's on the website again. You can go right to it from, you see the DoD Cyber Exchange. There's a thing there for STIG tools, and you can download it here. It's a Java jar file when you extract it. So basically, make sure you have Java installed, unzip it, double click it to start it, and then browse for either the XML or just the zip file itself. It can handle that. If you need to understand more about the viewer, there's a short little 9-minute video that somebody made. Again, I'll put this URL at the end, so don't worry about it, it's there. But basically, it's pretty simple to use. So here's what the STIG viewer looks like. I have a couple of STIGs loaded in here. You can see at the top left, whatever STIGs I have, and it can handle a whole bunch of them. I have the SQL Server one here that tells me how to deploy my SQL Server in a secure manner. And then I have my DISA ASD STIG in there as well. Now, at the bottom left, I have these filters. This is helpful because there's about 300 items in the ASD STIG, and sometimes I'm working on specific areas, especially if I'm a developer and someone has said, hey, make sure we don't have any of this kind of problem or that kind of problem. So you can search for SOAP, or you can search for logging, or you can search for static code or things like that. So it really helps you. The actual STIG requirements or vulnerabilities show up in the center box. On the left side of that box is the ID, the ones that I've been referencing. On the right side is the actual rule name or requirement name, so it's there for you. And then the right side is where things get interesting, right? And this is where people sometimes miss. We have all the details, so let's go over these boxes. The first is, what is this thing? And you can read the title, and like this one says, the application must not be subject to error handling vulnerabilities. Okay, that's a really big, broad, vague thing. And then the next box down is the discussion. And this is great because sometimes you read that and you either it's a little too vague like this one is, or you don't understand why it matters or really like what particular area that it matters in. And so in this discussion box, you get that rationale. Here's what you're supposed to do. Here's the kind of problems that happen if you don't do it. Here's some ways and things to think about as you're doing it. So it's why you should do this. And then in the next box, it's called check content, which is kind of an obscure titling because this thing is focused at an auditor. It's really the instructions for someone to validate that you've done this properly. So as a developer, these are like getting instructions, not from requirements, but from a tester. Right? So they're a little funny. And it's interesting because as we will see in a moment, when you look at some of these STIGs, the title may imply that it means one thing, and then the discussion may imply another, and then the check really is the final arbiter because the check tells you how it's going to be audited. And so if there's any discrepancies, confusion, ambiguity, the check content wins. So that's just something to know. And we'll show you some examples. Another thing that I like to point out, right, again, there's about 300 items. And they do have severity categories. And these, again, you know, they're defined by DISA. But category one are the most important. They're ones that directly and immediately result in loss of confidentiality, availability, or integrity. So, you know, denial of service, unauthorized access to files, changing permissions, blah, 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 all fall in that category. Cat two are things that have a potential. In other words, I look and I see there's a weakness. I don't necessarily know how to exploit it. I don't know the impact of it. And so if you look at the pie chart on the top right, you'll see that most of these items do fall in that cat two, where they're potential problems. And then cat three is the, you know, things that will degrade your measures. So again, that's a very small number. It's only 22 out of almost 300. So it helps you if you're just getting started, like do all the cat ones first. If you have too many things to do, do everything in cat one first, and then do cat two. Okay, so as we're looking at the STIG, we promise to help understand what is an approach to trying to do DISA STIG, especially for developers. And as we read through the STIG, we find that the what you have to do tends to fall in four or five buckets. And so I wanted to describe these buckets. So one is an application code scanner. Now this is defined in the STIG itself, section 4.1. But basically this is what we think of like a static analysis tool. And then there are application scanners. And these are things that test the whole system. They don't look at the code. It's more black box. And it's not unit testing or component testing. We are logging into the interface and using the system, right, to look for common problems. So these are vulnerability scanners. This is pen test tools. These are activities that red teams would do, things like that. Whereas with the code scanner, we're looking at coding standards, OWASP. We're looking at those specific STIG requirements around overflow, race conditions, and error handling. There are a bunch of these that are manual review. In fact, it's maybe a third of them or so that say things like write a doc, check that a doc exists, write a procedure, check that a procedure exists. So there's really no tools to be done there, like do it. And you know, the checklist is what you need, and the STIG viewer provides that. And then there's a lot in a bucket that Wilhelm really named this do something, check something. And basically it has something that's similar, for example, to a UI test or a functional test. So they'll say, go to the admin interface and make sure that the password policy is set to a minimum of 12 characters. And then go to the UI and try to set a password of less than 12 characters. And then go to login and see if a thing happened or got logged. So it's that kind of a, it's a, you know, do an action, and then check it. It looks a lot like functional testing. It looks a lot like what testers are used to doing. So if you're a tester and someone came along and said, oh, you need to do this DISA thing now, and it's security, and this is funny audit, and you're like panicking, like, just think of it like functional test or UI test, because that's what it feels like. I put one more bucket here. Everything else, honestly, like, we've scrolled up and down this STIG hundreds of times, and I feel like the four buckets are probably it, but I reserve the right to change my mind and say that there's some other weird way to do things, but it's not the majority. These are the four most common ways. So I wanted to show you what this typical do something, check something workflow looks like. You have your application. You want to make sure it complies with DISA STIG. So you go to the admin console, you do something, you check a setting, you change a setting, you go to the UI, you log in, and then you go stare at the log files. And what we're saying here to get ahead of this is that you can bring in testing and monitoring tools. And again, we're going to demo all this so you'll see how it really works. This isn't abstract. This is going to be hands-on today. But basically, those tools would feed the admin console to make sure that they either gave it the right settings or gleaned the right information from the console to make sure the setting is what you expect. Then they can actually use the user interface, do a login, perform an action, do whatever it is, the workflow that they're supposed to do in the scenario. And then they can look at the log file and read it wherever it is. It might be it's on a local file system. It might be a Samba share, an NFS mount. It might be through FTP. It might be in a database. It might be JSON file, XML, et cetera. So tools that will help you get these things and then parse them. Because what you really don't want is a person holding a magnifying glass staring at a web server log. If you've ever done that, you know those things are, oh man, they are noisy. Like, they're just producing stuff so fast. So tools that look for things. So the other thing that I mentioned is that the real easy way to go after this thing is to do your code checking through OWASP, right? And we'll talk more about that in a minute. But basically, there is a specific requirement that says that you need to check the application for OWASP. And that requirement is really about testing the system. So it's going to be pen test tools and things like that. But as a developer, if you know that these are the requirements that are going to be tested, then you can use static code analysis configured for the same problems. And that should make sure that the auditors and testers aren't finding problems. So OWASP, for those who aren't familiar with it, it's the Open Web Application Security Project. It is a highly web-oriented standard. If you find something in it that really doesn't apply to you, like cross-site scripting, don't worry about it. Because if you have that checker turned on, it's not going to find anything. So it's not a big deal. It is, the standard itself is language independent. The tools that implement it tend to be language dependent when you're talking about code scanners. It is a top 10 list. It's not a comprehensive application security standard. It's not intended to do that. OWASP has lots and lots of other things that you can do. It's intended to be a get started point. But the truth is that most people are having such a challenge with cybersecurity that the top 10 list is all you can handle initially. There are about 50 sub items in it. So like if you finish that like basic top 10, there are ways to move forward. Some of these things aren't really statically analyzable. In particular, this A9 using components with known vulnerabilities, also known as software composition analysis or supply chain analysis or securing your supply chain, basically says, hey, if you're using open source access jar, you need to make sure that there aren't any known vulnerabilities, CVEs, something in the National Vulnerability Database, that you're on the latest version, that you've applied the patches, so that something that shouldn't be a 0 day becomes a 0 day for you, right? 0 days really aren't 0 days once they're a patch, except that if you didn't apply the patch, then they are. You're always living in 0 day if you haven't patched. So the other interesting thing is that there is a risk scoring system for this. And this really helps, again, because static analysis can have a tendency to flood you with details initially. And so you need ways to prioritize and understand what's there. And so with OWASP, they look at exploitability. How easy is it for someone to take advantage of this? And then prevalence. This may or may not matter for you, but it's like, how often do we see this kind of problem detectability. In other words, if it's there, how hard will it be for an attacker, for a bad actor to figure out that you have it? And then the technical impact, right? Like if they exploit this, what'll happen, right? Can they change the date on my copyright? Like that's not a big deal. Can they cause denial of service in a first responder system? Very big deal. So obviously, if you take all four categories and look for things that are red in all four, like that's your sweet spot. And that probably takes your findings down to, you know, 3-5% of what they were. Again, a place to start. Ultimately, in this model in DISA STIG, you're going to be tested against all of them. I'm looking at prioritization to get started and to help you assess what's going on. So we did that poll already, so we'll skip it. So now we wanted to actually take a look. So Wilhelm, if you can bring up the STIG viewer for us. And I do see someone mentioned, right, that there is a V4R9 out now as well, so of the ASD STIG. So there isn't usually a lot of difference between the STIGs, but you do want to be on the latest version. So thanks for that, Steve. Okay, so this is the STIG viewer. So again, you see on the left, I have my particular STIG that I'm doing. And then down in here, I can type something like static, oops, if I can type. Okay, so now you see it says I have five things that are static. Of course, the funny thing is that if you look at some of these like this one, this isn't static code analysis. So, you know, the vagaries of the internet era, if I'd said static code instead of static, it would have gotten me that list of three that we had talked about. And you can remove individual filters or remove all the filters to get back to where you came from. So I just wanted to show that. But as we talk about this approach using the STIG viewer, I'm just going to like pick some of these at random, right? So you see here, the application must automatically audit account disabling actions. So again, if you come to this discussion area, you can see that we need to make sure that when people are trying to do something to disable an account, that there's an audit trail on it. And if we look at the check content, we have this examine documentation. Okay, that's one of our doc buckets. Interview the administrator and determine if it's configured that way, right? Like, is it using Active Directory? If here's the beauty, right? Like, if you're using an approved system for accounts, then you get like a pass, which is really cool because the system itself is susceptible to a specific STIG for the system. So it's part of how the whole thing works. If not, then you have to figure out where the audit logs and review the end of the log. So this is now do something, check something, right? Access a user account, disable a test user account, examine the log, determine if you saw it, right? And then down here, this is what you tell people, you screwed up, fix it. But from a development perspective, I'm less concerned. That's really for auditors. So that comes down to a, you know, isn't there always a like talk to administrator review docs, Wilhelm?
Yeah, it feels like a lot of them have
that. Yeah, but then there is a piece of it that I could build a tool for depending on how frequently I'm doing it. So if I was one of those people that I do this annually and the application changes radically, in the part of the application that's changing, I probably wouldn't record a tool. But in the part of it, like account administration, that's probably staying the same, I would record a tool. If I'm doing this monthly, I absolutely would record tests for all these. So here's another one, report generation. The application must provide report generation capability that supports on-demand reporting requirements. So, you know, again, we look at it, explains why we want them, and it must be capable of generating on-demand, customizable, ad hoc, as-needed reports so that people can report issues more quickly. And then if we look here, review the documentation, interview the administrator, because that's everything. Access it with user rights. So there's our do something. Navigate the UI and select the functionality. There's our do something. If there's a central logging solution, then check that it happened. Create a report and review it. So this is do something, check something else. Okay, I could automate that, right? So I just want to check like one more just for fun. And again, I'm just like picking at random here. It looks like there was another question that came in. I just want to make sure. No, we're good. Okay, so unnecessary built-in application accounts must be disabled. Oh my gosh, this is so great, right? Like, I have this thing called the IoT Hall of Shame, and things like web cameras and home routers are constantly being hacked, and it's very frequently that it's a default account, right? Like, people know that they can go in, and it's, you know, the sysadmin password is sysadmin and the password is password, right? And so you look and it's like sysadmin login, sysadmin password, password. So you don't want this stuff. So again, it talks to how would I do this, examine the account, verify, you know. So this is manual review, right? Like you're kind of stuck here. You got to go look for it. There are some cases where if you know specific patterns for an application, you could create a very custom static analysis type of checker that would look like, if we knew that our default password was password 123, I could build a static analysis checker that looked for password 123 anywhere in the code or config files. And that would at least help make sure that the auditor wouldn't end up finding anything. Because what's an auditor going to do? He's going to start grepping, right? Like, if there's 10 million lines of code, it's going to take a while. So with that, I think we want to show some actually how would we do this on some real practical ones, Wilhelm.
Yeah, perfect. All right. So so Arthur covered two main buckets that we're going to be going over in the practical section here. And the first area I'd like to start is the do something, check something. So I have three different examples that I'd like to cover. So the first one, 69279, let's actually look at that real quick. Here. All right, so this one says messages protected with WS security must use timestamps with creation and expiration times. So basically, if you have SOAP web services and they're secure services, we have to check for this, right? And this one I found to be actually super interesting, because what an AppSec person would do to demonstrate conformance with this STIG is different than what a development and test group should do to ensure that the application conforms with the STIG, right? So it's, and this is a theme that we're gonna see repeated as we explore various different STIGs and, you know, what the application team ought to do and what the STIG is recommending or requiring that the compliance person checks whether it conforms or not to do. So, you know, what we're seeing here is that the STIG is really written for an AppSec audience. But if you think about the SDLC, there is a big gap between where AppSec is and where dev and test get involved. And, you know, sometimes what you do to demonstrate conformance is also what you should do in dev and test. So it's very situational to the rule. But as I said, this one is really interesting because what you do is different. So if we take a look here, I've got a test that I've written that has two different examples. And what's neat about this is SOATEST actually helps in both cases. So in this first case, what we're doing is the STIG rule is saying, look at all the SOAP messages that your secure SOAP services are receiving and check to make sure that the requests have this username and nonce elements in the WS security header. So what SOATEST is allowing me to do is I've got a directory here with all the SOAP messages that I've recorded and sort of captured from the various different services I have. You know, one interesting thing is if you have a service virtualization practice in your organization, capturing all these messages actually becomes really easy. You know, rather than using Wireshark or something, it's sort of because you have the process, capturing this stuff becomes an afterthought. But I've captured all these request messages, and essentially I'm running the content of those request messages through a pattern checker that SOATEST has, where we have a specific rule: use nonce and timestamp values in username token headers, right? And the name of this rule that we have is security SOAP replay. And it's kind of funny, if you read about this particular STIG rule, all right, it's saying the application can be susceptible to replay events, right? So if there's no timestamp, an attacker could essentially take these recorded requests and use them in the future, and your application isn't checking those timestamps, so they could gain unauthorized entry at a later date. It's pretty serious.
Yeah, and this is really, you know, kind of similar to that recent NASA hack where someone went and dropped a little Raspberry Pi in and was replaying some traffic, right? Like, it wouldn't be hard to do.
Yeah. So, you know, here, as the AppSec person would do, right, instead of checking visually, manually, each and every SOAP message for all your services, with SOA test, I just ran my directory of logged messages through this scanner. And sure enough, actually, we've got some errors here. So, you know, this is what you do from the ensuring that or checking whether you're conforming to the STIG rule or not. But what should you do if you're in development and test? It's actually different. All right. So here I've got a SOAP client that SOA test is allowing me to send a message to a secure SOAP service. And I've got a WS security header configuration here. So I'm passing in a username token. So if I run this test, we'll notice this is the request XML that's being sent. If we switch to this view and strip out some of the XML, it's easier to read. You'll see, sure enough, we're sending our username token, and but there's no timestamp and there's no nonce element. Now, if we look at the response, our service is returning some data. So that's good, right? Actually, no, that's bad. The service should not be returning a response, right? The service should be built in such a way where if the request is insecure, there should be a SOAP fault. And that's exactly why this test failed, right? Because I'm checking for a SOAP fault and a SOAP fault didn't come. So this is a negative test, right? This is a finding. And if I show you guys, if I just sort of artificially induce the request to do a SOAP fault as a response, right now my test is passing. So this is a negative test. So I thought this example was quite interesting because it's something that SOA test can help with in both areas. But more importantly, it's an example of something that what the auditor does and what the dev and test teams do is different. All right, so let's look at another one here. So this one is interesting because what you do to demonstrate conformance is actually the same thing that the tester should do if they chose to create an automated regression test for this. So 69555, let's look at that one real quick. So basically, the application must enforce a minimum 15 character password length. All right, pretty straightforward. If we look at the check content, what is the auditor going to be doing here? Basically, right, log in as an administrator, create an account, and when prompted for a password, put in a password that's smaller, and then check to make sure that the application complies. All right, so I've got a web functional test that I've recorded on a web application we have. And if I play it through, we're going to see logging in, we're coming in, we're creating a new user in the admin area. We've got a validation message, but my test is failing. If we look at the validation that I have set up, I actually have a validator that's checking the error message and it's saying that, well, it's not 15 characters, right? This particular web application only allows a minimum of 3 characters. Right, so this is an example of something an auditor would do manually that you could set up as an automated regression test, run it with your nightly builds, and ensure that, you know, this is something that's not going to come up, right? It's, you can mark this one off your list if you're checking for it in an automated way. Now, not all the STIG rules here are quite as simple as this to automate. You know, some of them are actually pretty difficult. So there is this balancing act. If you're from the dev test perspective, you're thinking, well, how much of this makes sense for us to try to automate and how much not? But this one, this next one I'm going to show you is actually interesting because on the surface, it seems like it's something that might be difficult to automate because we have to actually do more than just do stuff on the UI. The checking stuff looks like it might be tricky. 69399. So for this one, essentially what we're doing is the application must generate audit records if there is an attempt to delete a security group. So, you know, if you have user roles, right, different permission sets for your application, and you go and you try to delete one of the roles, the application should log that event so that you have this audit trail, right? If an employee goes crazy and just deletes a bunch of stuff, right? You want to know when it happened, how it happened, who did it, etc. So, and I should say, there's two parts to it, right? It's the check content, one successful attempt, one unsuccessful attempt. If we look at the unsuccessful attempt, this is pretty straightforward. You try to log in. The application doesn't let you log in because you don't have the permissions to change the things. Okay. The much more interesting one is the successful attempt where we go delete the group and then we check the logs. And how we're checking the logs, right? This is where it seems like it might be difficult to automate. But with the right tools, it's easier than you might think. So I've got an FTP client here where I'm pulling the appropriate log file from the application server, right? So there's some configuration. You need to have access to the application server to grab a log file from it if you want to automate a test. And then once I have that log file, I've got a search tool here where I can check for the existence of certain strings within that log file. There's a ton of complexity or configuration here to do for the specific use case that you need. But I didn't have to write a bunch of code to do this, right? Like on the surface, it seems difficult, but it's actually not that bad for a lot of these cases, right? So if we look at the successful attempt, we're going to come in, log into our user administration page, delete a group. And once we delete that group, FTP that log file from the server and then check that log file. So we've got a page load. All right, we delete the group. And in this particular case, our server is logging these actions. So our test is passing. There's no findings here for this case. All right, so these are some of the examples of the do something, check something bucket of STIG rules that I wanted to show you. There's a lot more we could go through, but I feel like this gives you a good sense of, you know, what it would be like as a tester or a developer if you wanted to go ahead and start automating some of these things.
Right. I think, you know, the important thing, what we're trying to accomplish today is when you're looking at this giant thing and you're scared that this mountain of 300 items, almost 300 items, that this is how you'd approach it. You'd look at it. Don't just be able to stop and think, can I automate this? How hard would it be to automate it? How much is it going to change? How much is it going to save me, right? Like, you need to take a very rational approach to this because automating the whole thing won't be the right choice, but automating none of it is probably also not the right choice. So you're going to have to find that balance.
All right. So the next bucket that Arthur covered was the static code analysis, right? So if we come in and we add a filter for the OWASP keyword here, you'll see that we've got 9 different STIG rules that reference OWASP. And, you know, it's kind of funny, OWASP has a top 10, but we only have 9 STIGs here. But regardless, you know, this is an important consideration as the development team if you're thinking about security, right? Like if you want your application to pass with flying colors at audit time, You really want to focus on the secure, the how secure the code, how securely the code is written. And what's interesting as an example here, right? If I add static code analysis as another keyword where it checks for the existence of a STIG where both of these exist, right? You see that actually there's zero, right? So this illustrates that the DISA ASD STIG, it's written with penetration testing in mind. You know, try to break the live system, find holes in the running application. And this is where we have another divergence, like we were seeing earlier, between what an auditor must do to demonstrate conformance with these rules versus what development and test ought to do to ensure that their application passes that audit. And so if we take a look at the three STIGs Arthur was talking about earlier, besides just run static code analysis on OWASP and make sure that your code is written securely, the STIG also explicitly references three other things that you should use static analysis for in your application. So, as a recommendation, on top of doing OWASP, do these three other things as well. And that's a great starting point. As the application team, you do this and you're going to have an easier time come audit because you're following these secure coding standards, these secure coding best practices, right? There's the reason the industry calls them that. It's because they work. You follow these best practices, your code will be more secure. So let's take a look at that. All right. So here we have Parasoft's development testing platform. It's a reporting and analytics application. And I've got an OWASP top 10 dashboard here that covers essentially our compliance framework that tells you at a glance, am I compliant, am I not in compliance? You can notice that risk table Arthur was showing earlier is also integrated here. So if you wanted to dive into the specifics of any one categorization of all the findings for your particular project, you can do that. If we take a look at the compliance report, you'll notice that even though you're not required to be compliant to with OWASP for passing a DISA audit, it sure is nice having a compliance framework that you can internally validate that your code is compliant to OWASP,
yeah,
right?
The question I have is, will I pass the audit? And also there's a secondary question, which is if I'm accepting code from someone else, this would just be part of my acceptance testing, right? Like, mm-hmm. I don't want to wait till the whole application is built and then go, oh man, they wrote the code wrong in the first place. So doing OWASP at the code level is a great way to make sure that your suppliers are doing the right thing and a great way to tell your vendors that you're doing the right thing. And we actually are gonna, you know, show you these reports as well.
Absolutely. All right, so besides just running the analysis, collecting the data, allowing you to view the data from the web interface, there's also a PDF report that can be generated here that has all the relevant data that you can use to demonstrate compliance to OWASP. So for example, all the OWASP top 10 weaknesses are here. Compliance status. Weakness detection plan is actually very interesting because this breaks down, well, you know, injection flaws, OWASP A1, that's a pretty big category. There's a lot of sub items related to that. And how are you checking exactly injection flaws, right? So it lists the mapping between what you're checking for to the standard. Deviation report, essentially, when developers add additional context to the process where they go, you know, this is a module that's not really exposed to any users. There's very low security risk. You know, this finding doesn't make sense. All of that needs to be documented as well, right? If the checker found something, but it's irrelevant, right? That should be documented.
Yeah, and so the beauty of this system is that this isn't a, let me go through and do a whole bunch of compliance and audit like overhead at the end of my process. the developers sit into the dashboard. And in fact, let's go back to the first dashboard and click like easy or something, right? And they sit in there and then click one. Yeah, they sit in their violations, they work, they do their thing. They might even be in their IDE, not in the web interface. And they look at things, they fix things, they suppress things, they change priority, they put notes. All of this is part of the normal workflow for handling static analysis violations, right? Nothing is different. What happens is that automatically the system produces from that normal activity these compliance reports without any extra overhead.
Right.
And in fact, if you go back or scroll to the top of your compliance report to the plan, yeah. And yeah, the compliance overview and then the next one. Yeah. So this one, you know, Wilhelm was talking about, like on the left, I have the requirement that I'm trying to meet, for example, OWASP A1. On the right, I see the checker IDs that are used to implement that. And if you look at those checker IDs, I know it's small on your screen, but if you just stare in there, you'll see that they're actually named OWASP 2017 A1 dot blah, blah. So when you get a violation, when you're looking as a developer in your IDE and you get this message from the static analysis scanner in the CI, you don't have to ask yourself, what requirement is this for? So it's really designed to make the compliance activities organic to the activities of improving, you know, writing and improving and testing your code.
Yeah. So I haven't forgotten about those three other STIG rules that are explicitly called out that you must use static analysis for. So I'll jump into test configurations real quick. And we can actually show you how one might go ahead and say, okay, OWASP, great. I can enable those configurations. You can see we've got OWASP top 10 as a built-in configuration that you could then go expand to. So for example, if I needed to do some static analysis checking for overflow, you'll notice we've got lots of different checkers that cover very specific cases related to preventing buffer overflow, read overflow, write overflow, integer overflow. There's a bunch out there, right? And turning on what you want and building a configuration that covers OWASP and these other things is pretty trivial, right? If I want to look for race conditions, you know, now I've got a bunch of checkers that are looking for things in the code that might result in race conditions. Don't do this and you'll be okay. So, yeah, I know we kind of covered a lot and that's all we had for the demo portion. So let's kind of wrap it up a bit.
All right, so I want to give a bit of a summary here, right? So clearly, if you want to get ahead of this thing, you need to have static analysis tools. There are a few of the STIG requirements that explicitly call for static analysis. In addition to that, there are some things that you could do, like OWASP Top 10, that for sure someone's going to ask you about. And then there are a bunch of other things you could do to try and get ahead of it. So if you're looking at static analysis tools, you should look for making sure that they run in your IDE, because you want developers to actually fix these things, right? This isn't just a reporting activity. Again, this is supposed to be organic. So it needs to work in the IDE. It needs to run on the build server, the CI system, whatever you're using, having a CLI for a C build, you know, working with Make. Centralized configuration control is so important, because here, you know, Wilhelm started with an OWASP top 10 configuration and then he went, oh crud, I forgot the overflow. And overflow turned out to be not trivial, because is it buffer overflow? Is it integer overflow? Is it numeric overflow? Is it underflow? Is it, oh my gosh, right? Like overflow is everywhere. It's the bane of aircraft, right? The Dreamliner has two different integer overflows in it. So having centralized control means that what Wilhelm just showed you in changing that configuration, when I go to execute, I'll automatically use the right configuration because it's stored on a server. So there's no, how long would it take me to update 5,000 engineers with the right configuration, and is Bill doing the right thing? I don't have to worry about it.
Centralized reporting, audit analytics, again, very important because we want the audit activity to be as painless as possible. If I was going to like break my pull down further, it would have been, how much time do you spend in, you know, doing the analysis for STIG, how much time in responding to STIG, and how much time doing data collection and reporting activities for STIG. And I would hope that I could eliminate, you know, most of that category and some of the second category, right? The first category where it has, you know, go talk to Steve and Mary and find out like what configuration they said, I can't help you, right? Like you got to do that, right? Like that's it. And make sure whatever tool you get has a full range of checkers. A lot of people really get hung up on, hey, let me use the ones that find the vulnerabilities, that find the exploits, because they're really exciting. But to really comply with this, when you're looking at things like race conditions and around policies, around logging, and error handling, you really need a rich set of static analysis checkers, not just flow analysis checkers that look for, you know, in data tainting. So just, you know, in a nutshell, we're at the end here. So, you know, we've tried to keep very abstract. This should all work in any tool. But just to show you what we did, right, because we are both working at Parasoft, we have a static analysis framework. It's built on our compliance framework. It's the same thing we use for DO-178B and C for aircraft. We use it for ISO 26262 for functional safety in automobiles and things like that. We use it for FDA, for medical standards. We have complete support for all the critical standards. So CERT, CWE, OWASP, DO-178, MISRA, you know, like PCI, if you're taking credits as part of this, so many things. We use what I like to call this mapless implementation, right? The standard thing when you find a static analysis tool, like you go grab some open source tool, and then you analyze the entire set of checkers against OWASP and try and figure out which ones are for the standard. With Parasoft, you don't do that. You just like click it. Not only do we have a config, but the checkers are named for the standard, no matter which standard you're using. Standard-centric reporting. So as you saw, right, like all the items reported based on the OWASP categories or the CWE or CERT categories. And we've implemented risk models for each of these standards. So we do have the OWASP one that we showed. If you look at the lower right here, you can see scores based on CWE, scores based on CERT as well. So whatever you're using, we can help you prioritize, and we work right within the IDE. The other interesting thing, as I said, is to eliminate this overhead, which is we have audit-ready reports. So that means that you click a button and you get whatever you need. And in fact, you can get like any individual report we have can be downloaded as a PDF, but there's literally a button in the web interface there that you click and you get, boom, you got your compliance report overview. You've got the title page. The overview actually has the summary of your findings. You get your deviation report with specifically who, when, where, what, why. You've got your detection plan, which is really that map, and we're mapless, so like the map comes automatically. And then actually a run report, like when did I last run this and what were the results from it? Getting you close to that like reporting nirvana, right? Like that I just have what I need, right? Now I can sit and relax rather than, you know, chasing data. Now, if we're looking from the functional test automation side, like we're going to try and automate some of this. Here's some basic things, again, you should be looking for in tools. You want to make sure that creating these things is easy. Sometimes you need to script them programmatically, but like when you're looking at web interfaces, it's often easier to do like record and playback, visual creation, some kind of scriptless creation. So it's important to look and make sure that you have all these things. And in the modern world, like AI powered creation, even in functional testing, to really augment what the tester's doing, to do a lot of the work behind the scenes. Like they saw me log into a web page and recognize that I'm reusing data and recognizing the authentication mechanism and storing the credentials for reuse in a test. So AI powered creation is really great. Make sure it handles common authentication mechanisms. I have to say that when I talk to people about functional test automation, like number one question is, oh, can it handle OAuth? Can it handle blah, 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 right? Like over and over and over and over. So make sure that whatever authentication mechanisms you're using, whether it's LDAP or Active Directory or whatever, make sure that the tool you're going to try and automate with can do this before you start. Because if you end up with something you can't authenticate, you're dead in the water. Make sure you have logic, because again, these tests, frequently they're permutations of the earlier test. Like try to set the password too short, try to set it too long, try to set it with the wrong characters. Like that could be one test for me, right? If I did it right, and that's a lot less to maintain and break. Making sure that you can deal with test data management as these tests get complex. Sometimes it may take these, they all sound simple when we describe them, but when we get into implementing them, we might need actual like real user type data. You need to make sure you have some kind of monitoring system in your functional test, because as you see, do something, check something, is kind of useless without check something. So make sure that you can reach into event logs, make sure you can reach into the system itself and look at packets, things
like that. You know, it might be a JMS queue that you have to go check to make sure a message got posted to a queue or a database. I mean, there's a wide variety of different mechanisms that you might be required to check. So the broader the support for protocols and functionality the tool has, the better prepared you'll be to handle all the various different kinds of scenarios you might have to face if you're looking at automating, you know, some of these various rules.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to have a scenario where some of the things can't be automated because your tool choice was poor, or I have, you know, one tool for EDI and one for IoT stuff and you know, one for REST interfaces. Like that's just not sustainable. And again, at the build level, like making sure all the standard build types, you know, can I use a continuous integration? Can I use a command line? Is there plugins for Jenkins, et cetera? Is there API so I can integrate it with my own like really complex, really hip, really cool automated build deployment system? So those are just some of the capabilities you should be looking for. So in summary, because you know, we were talking about how do I approach DISA? Understand that if you're an ops team, if you're a security team, you're gonna have to do everything on this list. Anything we've talked about, prioritization, categorization, isn't really a thing, right? Like you're gonna have to do it. Some of it can be automated. You need to look at that. You need to decide, is this worth it? Is this not worth it? Now for developers, most of this is audit activity, but there are things you can do in other to prepare yourself for an audit. And again, if you're working in a client vendor supplier relationship, you need to make sure that either code you're getting is accepted because it's right, or code you're giving will be accepted because it's right. So use static analysis for the OWASP top 10 and add in overflow checkers, race checkers, error handling checkers to fit your needs. You can even shift left some of this testing with code analysis. A lot of the things that a pen test OWASP tool would do, like a SQL injection, can be checked earlier at a flow analysis level. Again, this doesn't replace the audit. It just means that I have confidence giving someone this code, whether it's an auditor or a client, that SQL injection is not going to happen. Turn on code smells and preventative standards. When you've reached that basic level of compliance, I know I can pass the audit, and you're like, what next? I want to harden this thing. I want it to be better, 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 better. You can start to turn on more checkers, preventative standards. Like if I look at error handling, there's a whole bunch of best practice error handling checkers that if they fire, they don't necessarily mean you have a vulnerability. They're a cat three or maybe even a cat four, right? But if I follow them, they produce code that is less susceptible to error handling problems. So it's just something to do. From a tester perspective or an auditor perspective or an acceptance tester, like look at the STIG requirements and decide, does this one make sense to automate? Like, can I automate it? And I challenge you on the can, because again, we looked a lot and said, no, I can't. And then we went, okay, I could. Like, so think out of the box a little. We're happy to take questions on those later, like either here or offline. Send us an email if you go, how would you automate this one? How would you automate that one? We'd be happy to do it, maybe put together a little blog or something or a follow-up to everybody. And make sure you're manually testing the ones, A, that can't be done, but also the ones that the cost of automating and maintaining the automation is higher. So pieces of the code that frequently change, not good candidates. Pieces of the code that are constant, stay the same, very good candidates. If you're frequently doing audit type efforts and test type efforts, great. If you're in a CI system and you're doing continuous, and maybe you're even CD where you're pushing it out live, then you definitely want to automate as much as possible so that you have a confidence that what you're building and deploying matches as much of the STIG as possible. So with that, we have a couple of minutes left. Well, we're actually right at the time. So we'll take whatever questions we had offline and we'll mail you all of the answers. If you'd like to hear anything else in future webinars, if you want to dive deeper in specific areas on this, please feel free to let us know. We'd love to do more about this. We thank you all for your attendance today and have a great day.